In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Beneath the cross of Jesus, I find a place to stand.
For our goodnight message on this Friday, the 18th of March 2022, broadcasting from the Salesian Pontifical University, Rome, Italy, by your servant Father Eustace Siame, a Salesian of Don Bosco, we listen to the story behind the hymn Beneath the Cross of Jesus by Elizabeth C. Clefan on this third Friday of the Stations of the Cross.
Of Jesus, my unworthy soul is one.
Since we decided to be focusing on the cross on Fridays of this Lenten period, we are going to listen to the story behind the hymn Beneath the Cross of Jesus by Elizabeth Cecilia Douglas Clefan, who was born in Scotland in 1830 and died in 1869 at the age of 39. She was a daughter of a country sheriff, and she lived most of her brief life near Edinburgh. Though in frail health most of her life, Elizabeth found the strength to help the poor and sick in her town. She and her sister gave all that they could spare to charity, it is said, selling their horse and carriage for the benefit of the needy. The townspeople of Melrose referred to Elizabeth as the sunbeam. Beneath the cross of Jesus, focusing on the shelter of the cross, was first published 3 years after the author's death in 1872 under the title Breathings on the Border. Perhaps a double entendre referring to a geographical location near Melrose, the Scottish borders, and a reference to the border between life and death. This poem and others of ours appeared in the Scottish Presbyterian magazine, The Family Treasury, submitted by an unknown source, perhaps a family member or a friend. One source suggests that this hymn was written within 1 year of her death, in 1868. The hymn is full of comforting and perhaps paradoxical language about the cross, after all, an instrument of the cruelest torture. These include in stanza 2, the shadow of a mighty rock, a home within the wilderness, a rest upon the way. An omitted third stanza provides additional images of consolation. A happy shelter, refuge tried and sweet, a trysting place, and a ladder up to heaven, a reference to Jacob's ladder. And the words go like this: O safe and happy shelter, O refuge tried and sweet, O trysting place where heaven's love and heaven's justice meet. As to the exiled patriarch, that wondrous dream was given, so seems my Savior's cross to me, a ladder up to heaven. Originally 5 stanzas, another omitted stanza, perhaps autobiographical, provides further insight into the comfort that the writer found in the shadow of the cross and the inspiration that the cross gave her as she anticipated her own death. There lies beneath its shadow, but on the further side, the darkness of an open grave that gapes both deep and wide. And there between us stands the cross, 2 arms outstretched to save, like watchmen set to guard the way from that eternal grave. Such explicit anticipation of and longing for death may seem somewhat morbid today, but echoes the romantic literary sentiment of our time. Though appropriately sung during Lent and Holy Week today, this hymn is more of a personal meditation on the cross and one's own mortality than a hymn written for a specific time of the Christian year. The contrast between this 19th century romantic perspective of the cross and the early 17th century understanding expressed in the famous hymn by Isaac Watts, "When I Survey the Wondrous Cross," of 1707 is significant. Only the salient differences can be mentioned here. While Crefan's cross is one of shelter and comfort, Watts' cross is one of redemption. Crefan scarcely mentions the one who hung on the cross, while Watts focuses our attention to the dying Christ in stark detail in the first line of the following stanza. "See from his head, his hands, his feet, sorrow and love flow mingled down. Did ever such love and sorrow meet, or thorns compose so rich a crown?" Crefan's hymn incorporates an intensive list of comforting images, many biblical, while Watts interprets the scene of a dying Christ theologically. Following the first line of the stanza just cited, Watts, through the use of metaphor, transforms blood and water into love and sorrow, and thorns into a regal crown. He concludes his hymn with a rhetorical question that cannot be answered, except to say, "No, nothing like this has ever happened in the history of the human race." Finally, Crefan places her encounter with the sheltering cross as an act of personal solace. She wants to remain spiritually in the shelter of the cross. "I take, O cross, thy shadow for my abiding place." A final stanza states she is content to let the world go by, to know no gain or loss. Watts, on the other hand, shifts our gaze from the crucified Christ to the whole realm of nature and calls for our total commitment. "Love so amazing, so divine, demands my soul, my life, my all." The purpose of this comparison is not to ascribe a higher quality to one hymn over another, for both bear faithful witness to an encounter with the crucified Christ. The purpose is to demonstrate the difference between the early 18th century theological perspective of Isaac Watts and the spiritual encounter of a woman during the Romantic era of literature 160 years later. Elizabeth Crefan's reflection assumes a spiritual posture of meditation. Unlike what she states in her final stanza, "content to let the world go by," this was not her ethical posture, as she was not only aware of others' plight, but also shared all she could spare to meet the needs of the poor and infirmed within the limitations of her frail health and resources. Given the rich symbolism that is part of the cross in Christian experience, we need to sing both of these hymns, as well as many others on this theme, as we continue with our Lenten observance. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit.
As it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
And may Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Good night, as it dreams.
Same to you, Father.
Beneath the cross of Jesus, the path before the cross.